which is actually a 16th century allegorical satire. It's a comedy, but they're pictures of that, and that's me humoring myself having these pictures up there. So, pitter-patter heart, tiptoeing through 1 minute, galloping the next. That's my haiku for you all. All right. So, this is what classrooms used to look like. There would be a little cadaver, or maybe not someone who's quite dead yet, laid out here for all of the anatomists, the budding physicians, to stand around, raised high above, able to look down on the activities below. This is a very famous one that is in Italy, the theater Girolamo. Is that right? I can't speak Italian. I can't pronounce that very well. The Fabrizio d'Acquapendente, where in 1595 Venus valves were first appreciated. To call them discovered is probably not the right word, but they were first appreciated in this environment. So probably a bunch of you have done this before, played with your Venus valves. You get your arm going and you get the veins popping out, and you see these nodes along them, and you stick your finger on one, and then you clear the blood backwards from them, and then you take your finger off the node, and the blood comes back into the vein. It's the way your venous structure prevents backflow. We're going to talk about that at the end of the lecture today. Okay, so Van Leeuwenhoek in the late 17th century was a famous microscopist. He was kind of the first microscopist, and he was able to draw these first pictures of what he called red corpuscles. This guy was Dutch. And this is really the first drawing of red blood cells as such, going back to the 17th century and the development of optics. Then much later, this guy named Lionel Beale, once the technique, the microscopic technique had developed, got this pretty beautiful picture. Kind of abstract, lovely drawing of both red and white corpuscles. He realized there were red and white corpuscles as well in the blood, and that's the first description of that. So when we look at this, we can almost even pick out what we have here. Here's going to be some red. Maybe this is a monocyte of some sort. This looks like a platelet, maybe. Who knows? Maybe this is, some other kind of leukocyte. I don't see any neutrophils here. Maybe this is an activated lymphocyte. Pretty interesting. Okay, back to our buddy Galen. He had began to map out the heart a little bit. However, he understood that the right chamber of the heart, the right side of the heart, received blood from the vena cava, via the vena cava from the liver. And he didn't really, he was a pretty careful guy, but he hadn't fully mapped out everything. He believed that blood got from this side of the heart to the other side of the heart via tiny little pores that passed through the heart. So maybe he didn't map out the heart very well. Maybe he did his dissection on one of those 5% of the people in the population with the PFO who maybe had some kind of a pulmonary embolism and died, and he was able to dissect. Well, no, he wouldn't have been able to dissect a human back then, was it? was he able to? I don't know. No, but he thought there were pores that communicated from one side of the heart to the other. Leonardo also kind of got it wrong. It took a long time for them to figure out what was going on. He believed that the blood emanated from the liver and went everywhere else. So here's his drawing that was a little bit silly to us now. What does the blood do? Well, first and foremost, it is going to transport dissolved substances, oxygen, carbon dioxide, various nutrients, sugars, proteins, lipids, hormones, different waste products, and then, of course, the white blood cells, the leukocytes. It also serves as an important regulator of the pH in your body and the osmolality of your body, the ion balance of the body. The blood is able to clot, thus preventing fluid loss. It has built-in mechanisms that help in hemostasis and help to stabilize injury. The white blood cells help us to ward off pathogens and help metabolize and process toxins. Importantly, the blood, because it is fluid, has a high heat capacity. There's a high heat capacity in the blood, and consequently, it plays a major role in stabilizing the body temperature. It takes a lot of energy to freeze a bucket of water as big as you are, but it also takes a lot of energy to heat it up. So it's kind of a thermal buffer. Having all of that fluid in the blood acts as a temperature stabilizer. All right, so let's look at the blood. We do some venipuncture here by a phlebotomist. We're going to gain a sample of whole blood, and we're going to spin it down, okay? We're going to put it in a centrifuge and spin it down. And it's going to separate itself into plasma and formed elements, the plasma and the formed elements. Plasma are things that are in solution, and the formed elements are the solid things that were suspended in the blood, but we can spin out because they're no longer suspended. All right. So the formed elements are about 37 to 54% of the blood. This is called the hematocrit. We'll talk about that in a bit. First, the plasma. Let's break the plasma down. So one thing before I get into that, just some basic features of the blood. Your blood is a little bit higher than the ambient body temperature. It's 100.4 degrees. If your body's at 98.4 or whatever, it's maybe a degree and a half or 2 degrees higher. It's very high viscosity because of all the stuff that's in it, much higher than water. Blood is indeed thicker than water. And then this is an important part right here, the pH. The pH range of life, where life is feasible, is 7.35 to 7.45 in the blood. The blood is actually a little bit alkaline. If 7 is neutral, the blood is just a little bit alkaline. It's a little bit basic. So those are important numbers that anyone in the health profession will eventually have to commit to memory. Pardon me. Feels good. The plasma is made up of 92% of its water. Okay. And the other 8%, so it's an 8% solution of other stuff. 7% of it is in proteins and 1% is in solutes. So what are these proteins? Of the 7% of plasma that is dissolved proteins, far and away, the vast majority of them are just kind of base proteins, basic proteins, albumins. Because of the high concentration of albumins, these are major contributors to the osmotic pressure in the blood, the ability of blood to facilitate diffusion. Albumins also act to transport lipids and steroid hormones that dissolve into the lipophilic portions of these albumins. So albumins are a class of proteins. Another major class, about one-third, albumins make up a little less than two-thirds of the blood proteins. One-third of them are these globulins, globular proteins. So again, globulins are a superfamily of proteins. There's a lot of different globulins that do all kinds of different things. Some of them are responsible for transporting ions, certain types of ions. Some globulins are able to act as hormones. Globulins transport hormones, transport lipids. But the globulins, part of the globulin superfamily, are the immunoglobulins. That's what antibodies are. So IgG, IgA, IgE, all of the isotypes of all those are all globular proteins, globulin proteins that have common evolutionary origins. Then we have fibrinogen, which is about 4% of the protein. And so this fibrinogen, so anytime you see a protein where the suffix on the protein says ogen, O-G-E-N, that means that protein is what's called a proenzyme. That is an enzyme who has not been activated yet. There's some kind of regulatory part on that protein that needs to get hydrolyzed off, that needs to get cleaved off for that protein to be activated. So fibrinogen gets hydrolyzed when you injure yourself and becomes fibrin and lays down fibrin networks that help form the clot. Okay, so fibrinogen is made by fibrocytes, and fibrinogen gets activated to fibrin, and that's used to form clots. So there's a lot of different proenzymes that you'll run into throughout your life if you continue in the life sciences. And then a small, less than 1% number of the proteins in solution are regulatory. And this is where 99% of the diversity of proteins are, right? There's like a vast array of proteins that are in your blood in extremely low concentrations, all right? And this is where a lot of forefront in medical diagnostics is identifying these proteins, identifying ways of monitoring these proteins, seeing what subtle shifts in the concentration of these proteins tell us about the state of affairs in a patient. Okay, so it's this, even though it's only 1%, these regulatory proteins, enzymes, proenzymes, different hormonal proteins, cellular byproducts, whatever. There's a whole host of different types of proteins. They can be really important if you know what you're looking for and you have the tools that are sensitive enough to pick them up. Then the other solutes. We have a lot of electrolytes. So the big players are sodium, potassium, calcium, magnesium, chloride, carbonate, phosphate, sulfate. So this is helping to maintain the osmolarity of the blood. There are various organic nutrients. So these can be the sugars, the various carbohydrates, amino acids from the breakdown of proteins, and then a host of different lipids. And then finally, the organic wastes that we will talk about that a little bit in the digestion lecture. But these are just metabolites of the cell, urea, uric acid, creatinine. We will talk about bilirubin in just a moment and ammonium. All right, so when you look at a spun down sample, you're going to have the plasma on the top and then the red blood cells and the white blood cells. The percent that this makes up of this total volume is called your hematocrit. All right, hematocrit. People measure your hematocrit to see what your red blood cell concentration is in your blood. And it's important. Maybe you're anemic and you have a low hematocrit. Or maybe you're hypervolemic and you have a really high hematocrit, large blood volume. At the top of this pack is what's called the Buffy coat. It's this coat of white blood cells. The white blood cells are a little bit larger than red blood cells, so it shouldn't be surprising that they're going to be on the top of the stack, and then you're going to have red blood cells down there at the bottom. All right, so looking at the formed elements, we're going to have, and this is just looking from the Buffy coat down, you're going to have platelets, which are very small in stature compared to these other cells. Then we have the white blood cells, and we talked in lab about the different shapes that they present. That's only one out of every 1,000 to 1,500, 1,400 cells in your blood is going to be one of these white blood cells. So they're very, it's a small number. Amongst them, the bulk of them are going to be neutrophils. So it says here 50 to 70%. That's probably correct. And then the rest are going to be lymphocytes with a smattering of these other ones. If only one in 1,000 cells is a white blood cell, and only one in 500 or one in 1,000 of those is basophils, every one in a, you're going to have to look at a million cells, anywhere from 500,000 to a million cells to even find a basophil. So they're actually quite hard to find on a smear. All right. We said a lot of this in lab already. RBCs don't have any nuclei or mitochondria. That means they are metabolically quiescent. They are not quiet. They're not doing anything. They do not have ribosomes. So they have no nuclei, they have no DNA, they have no mitochondria to make any energy, and they have no ribosomes to make new proteins. There's no repair. There's no metabolism. I shouldn't say that. Their only metabolism is anaerobic metabolism. So your body has to constantly be making new red blood cells. Your blood cells only last for about 120 days. You have to be constantly making new ones. Why? Tell me. Emma, you're right there. You're so clever. I know you're going to get this. Why is it smart for a red blood cell to only have anaerobic metabolism? What's the job of a red blood cell? Okay. So why might it be wise for a red blood cell to only have anaerobic metabolism? So it doesn't use the oxygen it's trying to carry, right? It's kind of like, it's a good thing to have a donut delivery driver not eat donuts, right? Because you don't want to eat your supply. All right. The reason these cells have a divot in the middle, in this depression, is to increase the surface area to volume ratio. I'm going to say this now because maybe this one thing, maybe this is the only thing you ever take with you from this class. But if so, it's a good thing because it will help you look at the physical world around you in an entirely different way. One of the fundamental guiding principles of all morphology, any kind of organized structure that you're going to see in the natural world around you, is this fundamental principle, physical principle, that I'm going to state it in the general first, and then I'm going to give you specifics so you can understand it, that you can fit in the ideal, you can fit an infinite amount of n minus 1 dimensional surface inside of a finite n dimensional surface. Okay? So in a finite n dimensional surface, whatever number n is, you can fit an infinite amount of surface that's one dimensional smaller. Okay? So for example, here we have a surface area to volume. Surface area is a two-dimensional surface, and volume is a three-dimensional structure. So you can fit an infinite, in theory, an infinite amount of two-dimensional surface inside of a three-dimensional surface. Okay, just like a snowflake has the shape that it has, it's because the perimeter is heading towards infinity. You have a finite surface area, but a potentially infinite perimeter, right? So surface area there is two, and perimeter is a one-dimensional surface. It's that basic principle which leads lungs to look like trees and look like broccoli, which leads... I could take you on a long adventure just talking about that, but that is, if you look for that phenomenon in a naturally occurring system, you're going to find it everywhere. Not just surface area to volume, but in general, you can fit any amount of n minus one dimensional surface in any finite n dimensional surface. So maybe that stimulates your minds. When you look at a capillary or an arteriole here, you're going to see these red blood cells. The shape of them is such that they're able to form these rouleaux. It's a French word. And rouleau just means like a roll or a stack of these red blood cells. And it helps them to be able to pass through a lot of them pass very quickly through a very narrow capillary. So I just said there were no nuclei, there were no ribosomes, there were no mitochondria in the cell. Well, what's in there? Yeah. Oh, yeah. It's just a function of the shape that they have. Because of the shape they have, they are uniquely able to stack with one another. So when you say coordinated, I'm not sure what that means, but it's just a fundamental principle of the shape that they have. It's just a fundamental principle of the shape they have. So like if you had a whole bunch of tiles that were in the shape of squares, and you put them all on the table, and you kind of shove them all along, they're going to eventually kind of align themselves, and it's just a function of the shape that they have. And it's the same thing here. It's the shape that these guys have allows them to form these stacks, which we call rouleau. These cells are full of hemoglobin. It's a globular protein. We said globulins are about one-third of the type of proteins in your plasma, in the serum. This globulin protein is packed in your red blood cells. And we're going to talk about the function of hemoglobin in much greater detail in the respiratory chapter. In fact, and I'm only going to scratch the surface there, hemoglobin... I remember having like four really painful long lectures in my kinetics, my physical chemistry kinetics class in graduate school in my biochem department. So hemoglobin is an incredibly sophisticated protein, the way it works, and we won't get into all of that, but we will talk about it a little bit. Hemoglobin is a tetramer. So we have four subunits, two alpha chains and two beta chains that work together in this sort of square arrangement with one another. Each of these subunits has embedded in it what's called the heme. So the heme is, if you were to take the iron, it's this iron-containing structure here. If the iron is gone, all of this is called the porphyrin ring. That's the porphyrin ring. Then you stick an iron in there, we call it the heme. All right. So the heme plus the globulin is the hemoglobin. This iron is specifically what binds to oxygen. And the heme molecule, as it's embedded in hemoglobin, when it has oxygen and or doesn't have oxygen, it's going to slightly change the geometry of that porphyrin ring. It's going to be either buckled up or buckled down, depending on whether the oxygen is bound. And when that happens, it's going to subtly change the architecture of the hemoglobin, which is going to affect the architecture of all these other guys, and then affect their ability to bind oxygen. This is going to be called a principle called allosteria, which we will learn about next week, allosteria. All right. So in most males, an adult male has about 14 to 18 grams per deciliter in whole blood of hemoglobin, whereas females have just a little bit less. Most females have a little bit a lower concentration of hemoglobin in their whole blood. And I'm actually not quite sure why that is, whether that's because women are constantly dealing with menstruation or what the rationale is for that. Anemia. Here's just a definition for you. When a person is anemic, they have a reduced capacity to transport oxygen. And this is typically due to a low level of hemoglobin. This HB is how we represent hemoglobin. Sickle cell anemia is this disease you see here where a normal red blood cell does not form properly, and it affects the ability of these people to be able to transport oxygen. So people with sickle cell anemia have a hard time transporting oxygen. Most of you probably already heard this story. Populations that have a higher incidence of sickle cell anemia tend to be from ethnicities that derive from places in the world that have a higher incidence of malaria. And it's because sickle cell anemia actually confers some protection against malaria. You steal from Peter to pay Paul here. You have to deal with the fact that you have anemia, you have a higher incidence of other thrombotic issues. Sandra, you had a question? So myoglobin is a monomer, it's not a tetramer, but otherwise it's quite similar. It's not allosteric because a hemoglobin molecule can bind four molecules of oxygen at once, but a myoglobin is only a single subunit, can only bind one oxygen at any given time, and it only lives in your muscle cells. It's not circulating, okay? But it is related. That was a good question. All right. So blood typing. We have different types of blood, and this is different types of blood cells in terms of the antigens that are being expressed on the surface. So an antigen is an epitope or a sequence of proteins or a sequence of amino acids that is characteristic of a certain protein or a certain that might exist in a special cell line or what have you. It's a bigger discussion. But in terms of this, we have these different cells, these different red blood cells that are going to express different types of antigens. So there's a type A antigen, which is depicted as a circle here, a type B antigen, which is depicted as a triangle. And then there's people with AB blood express both of these antigens. And then type O has neither A nor B on the surface of the red blood cells. So the significance of this is in
There's this thing called thymic deletion, and this may be the only immune system I talk about this semester. But the way the immune system works is rather than have DNA, so we have like all these different possible sequences of proteins, right? There's 20 amino acids, so a tetrapeptide, there's like 16,000 different possible tetrapeptides that you can have. And then if you look at a longer, an epitope is usually 8 to 12 amino acids long. There's like literally millions of different epitopes that you could possibly have. Your immune system doesn't devote DNA specifically to each of those possible epitopes, right? What it does do, however, is have a sort of random system where it makes, it has all, it makes all of, it doesn't explicitly code for all the possible antibodies. Instead, it is going to say, I'm going to make any possible antibody by saying I'm going to pick any of the 20 amino acids for this portion in an antigen or an antibody, and then again the second spot in an antibody, the epitope region, I'm going to pick 20 more amino acids. It has this system where it produces antibodies to everything. It just makes antibodies to everything. The problem with that, however, is that it makes antibodies against you, against your own tissues. Babies are born with the capacity to make antibodies against themselves. All right, there are T cells that are able to attack their own body. But luckily, some of the other amazing things, I mean, development, the embryology up through birth and development, that is so fascinating. One of the things that happens just postpartum is a process called thymic deletion. So the thymus is responsible, and you don't need to write all this down because I'm not going to quiz you on it, but you can write it down if you want to remember it. The thymus is responsible for cutting out, killing, first of all, identifying, recognizing any lymphocytes, T or B lymphocytes, that are self-reactive, that make antibodies against the self, and then killing them, deleting them from the subset of T cells that your body made that can recognize everything. Okay? It's called thymic deletion. And so the first, like, it happens during the first week, maybe 3 days, something like that. And this is one of the reasons why mother's milk is so important, and I won't get started on that because I'd talk on that issue all day. But so in a person who's got type A blood, they have these antigens out here. All of the type A antibodies that their body made, because everybody makes the antibody, they got killed during thymic deletion. They don't have those antibodies. They got edited out of their collection of T cells that make those antibodies. But the anti-B antibodies didn't. They survived because the thymus wasn't exposed to this B antigen. All right? And then this person with AB, their thymus killed both of these antibodies out. Whereas a person with O didn't have any of them deleted. All right? So they've got antibodies to everything. So that's why type O is the universal donor. You can stick these red blood cells, you can stick these red blood cells from a type O person into any of these other people, and you're not going to have a reaction with any of the antibodies. Type A is the universal receiver. They're a universal receiver. They can get blood from anybody, but they can't give it to anybody but other AB. All right? Type O can only receive blood from type O. If you stick one of these cells in a type O, that cell is going to be destroyed by these antibodies here. All right? You see how blood typing works? Any questions on that? I probably spent too long on that. Yeah.
Brain? The body. Oh, the body, yeah. Yeah, I mean, that's just, you inherit that from your parents. It's just a heritable trait, a heritable dominant trait. So it just, I don't know. Yeah, it's just, you pass on all kinds of traits from your parents, and this is one of them. Oops. Yeah, recycling. I debated over breakfast with my daughter cutting this slide out this morning. I'm not going to spend too much time talking about it, but this is just talking about the recycling of blood cells. So I said they last only about 120 days, 4 months. And a red blood cell gets made in the bone marrow and lives its life. And one of two things happens to it. Either it just breaks down, and it just, for whatever reason, it gets tore up and broke down as it's riding around. It breaks down on the side of the road, and it gets recycled, and the hemoglobin gets eliminated through the urine. The alpha and beta chains just get excreted. Or 90% of the red blood cells here get picked up by macrophages in the liver, spleen, and bone marrow as it's cycling around. These dump trucks pick them up and begin to break them down, break the proteins down into amino acids, recycle the heme, and oftentimes the porphyrin ring, so keep that iron and do something with the iron, but then the porphyrin ring gets converted into these chromophores called biliverdin and bilirubin. Verdin is a green pigment. Biliverdin becomes bilirubin and is a red pigment. This bilirubin, bilirubin and biliverdin get excreted into the bile and become part of the bile salts, which is part of how your body is able to absorb fats. But a lot of this bilirubin just goes out in the feces. Some of it goes back into the bloodstream and is eliminated through the urine. So about 3 million blood cells per second are recycled. Think about that. 3 million cells per second are being made and destroyed in your body every moment. Life is an ecstatic orgy of creation and destruction as we sit here in our composed repose. Hemostasis is what happens when you get a cut. I've already said a number of times this semester that this is super complicated, and I'm gonna way oversimplify it just by showing you this picture. But here you cut yourself with a pretty nasty looking blade, you get a smooth muscle spasm that tries to clamp off the smallest capillaries. And then we get the platelet phase. So this is the vascular phase. We get the spasm in vasoconstriction. Platelet phase, we get the platelets that become sticky and aggregate. And then the coagulation phase, this whole thing, the platelet aggregation releases different factors that start this complex clotting cascade. There's something like 30 different clotting factors that go in this cascade. You can see I'm cutting out even the like basic stuff here. Fibrinogen gets activated into fibrin and reinforces this platelet plug over the cut. So hemostasis. All right. How much time do I have here? I have an hour. Do you want me to test you guys on the anatomy, or should I assume that you know it? Was that useful yesterday when I went through the anatomy of the eye? Who wants it? None of you. Okay. All right. I'm going to assume you know the anatomy. I had
done, I had talked about this in lab, so I'm just going to review this so you understand it. We have the blood, deoxygenated blood, starts in the right atrium, gets pumped through the tricuspid, right ventricle pumps it out. The pulmonary valve through the pulmonary arteries, painted blue because of deoxy, heading towards the lungs, gets oxygenated in the lungs, returns via these pulmonary veins to the left atrium, where it gets shunted into the left ventricle, then ejected via the aorta to go to the upper and lower extremity, returning again to the right side of the heart, deoxygenated now as it has passed through the capillary beds to the right atrium via the superior and inferior vena cava. Two loops, the deoxy and the oxygenated loop. Okay. The heart wall. So we went through this diagram in lab. The one thing I will point out here is that we've cut the pericardium back. We can see the heart in situ sort of pinned down to the top of the diaphragm. Pericardium has been resected to show the heart. Here's a section of the heart wall. If we begin to look at this thick myocardium and look at the muscle fibers, the muscle fibers of the heart are kind of spiraled towards the apex. The heart doesn't just do that when it contracts. It sort of twists a little bit. Just a little bit. It kind of twists, kind of squeezing, wringing all the blood out of it. All right? So it when it contracts, it coils on itself just a little bit because of the spiraling muscle fibers. One of the things that's important about that is as it's spiraling, we have fibers that are crossing one another at orthogonal planes. In orthogonal, you know, not all the fibers are perfectly parallel. They kind of cross a little bit as the fibers spiral in towards the inside. That strengthens the wall of the heart. I mean, the heart is, as you may imagine, a pretty elegantly constructed piece of machinery. Here are some cardiac muscle cells, the myocardiocytes. The thing I'm going to point out here, we've talked about intercalated discs a little bit, and here is a cartoon of them. What's the point that I'm making here? Well, in any given one, there's only going to be one cell, and on the end there are these like plates that are the intercalated discs. Otherwise, they're essentially the same as skeletal muscle. If we look closely at an intercalated disc, so here's one cardiac muscle cell, here's another one, here are these myofibrils with the thick and the thin filaments, and this is the gap between the two myocardiocytes. This is like a real close-up of a little bit of an intercalation. They're connected with these desmosomes, and different plasma membrane proteins that underlie the plasma membrane here. And then, so this is on the adjoining face, and then on the longitudinal faces of adjacent cells, we're going to have gap junctions. So there's some sort of syncytium. This is providing strength longitudinally, these desmosomes, and then along the adjacent faces, we have the gap junctions. So in a skeletal muscle cell, the way we got a big coordinated contraction was through having the cell just be enormous. Well, the cardiac muscle cells did one better. They didn't just make giant muscle cells. They had normal muscle cells. Why make a giant muscle cell? We'll have a normal size muscle cell that has one nucleus that controls it. But we are going to connect all of the muscle cells together with these gap junctions. So it's not just one big muscle fiber. It's all of the muscle fibers are all on the same page. it's all syncytial, okay? So whatever calcium's getting dumped over here, it's over there too. If this membrane's getting depolarized, this membrane's getting depolarized, all right? Here's what it actually looks like. You've seen these slides in the lab, but this is what an intercalated disc is. It looks like histologically. I'm a little ready for a nap. All right, so looking at the left and the right ventricle, the left ventricle is by far the beefier side of the heart. Can anybody rationalize that for me? Okay. Yeah, it's got a pretty big hill to go up, right? It's got to shove the blood all the way down from your toes to your nose and everywhere in between. And the left ventricle, the right ventricle just has to get it to the heart, which is right next door. It's the next door neighbors. So don't need quite as much muscle for that. The valves of the heart. So here what we've done is, in this cartoon, we've cut the top of the heart off. We sliced right through the base of the heart, all right? And we've revealed what is called the cartilaginous skeleton, or the cardiac skeleton of the heart. Here's the cardiac skeleton. This is the stiff connective tissue framework of the heart. So here we see the two atrioventricular valves. Here's the tricuspid valve on the right. Here's the bicuspid or mitral valve on the left. These are both going in. So this is the right atrium, this is the left. And then this is the pulmonary valve. Remember I told you it's in the front. The dog ears would be coming here and here. The pulmonary valve is the one that's right in the front. And the aorta is right behind it. And then all the other valves are behind. The vessels are behind that. And it's these semilunar valves. And these kind of, they're stiff. You'll see tomorrow when you get, has anyone dissected a heart before? A couple of you, a few of you. For those who haven't, when you get your hands in there, you'll see they're stiff. There's actually some real resistance in the tissue. And they kind of snap open and can snap close. It's these semilunar valves. All right, so here's what it looks like when it's closed. The leaves are all pushed together. And then when this heart forcefully, the strong left ventricle contracts and the right ventricle, it forcefully ejects blood to the point when the pressure that has built up in this ventricle reaches and then exceeds the blood pressure in the aorta. It's got to be above the blood pressure that's in the aorta for it to push these doors open and then be able to actually eject blood. All right, so it's working against the pressure of blood in the aorta. And here we see it contracting, snapping that open, and the blood comes out. We can see here the opening for the right and the left coronary arteries that would be coming up and joining the aorta right here and here, just adjacent to those, the aortic valve. That's a fun little thing to look for. The real sharp dissection team tomorrow may be able to find that one in their heart. Okay, wow. How do you even take a picture like this? I don't know. But here it is. So this is a picture of the papillary muscles in the heart. And you have the chorda tendinae pulling down on the leaves of the tricuspid valve. This bad boy right here, that is going to be a moderator band. That's the moderator band I talked about. So the papillary muscles here, chorda tendinae, chorda tendinae, moderator band, not labeled. And then all this stuff in here, all this is going to be trabeculae carnae. So tricuspid, because we have 1, 2, 3 papilla for that tricuspid valve. heart disease, heart attacks. Does anyone have this running in their family? I do. So what does this mean? This means that with time, you know, say you have dyslipidemia, you have, you know, elevated bad cholesterol, you've got a lot of fat in your blood, and these macrophages that take this up become foam cells or what have you. Eventually, it becomes an inflammatory process and deposits itself on the walls as arterial plaque in the vessels. One of the problems with the design of the heart, and maybe it's not a problem with the design of the heart, but it's a problem with the modern diet. Maybe it's a problem with the modern expectation that humans will live to be 85 or something like that, is that these coronary vessels up here, because they're just adjacent to that aortic valve, they are subject to a lot of turbulent flow in the blood as it's being ejected from here and being forced into this coronary artery. That's really turbulent. So turbulence in blood is one of the things that can stimulate a inflammatory process, particularly if you're dyslipidemic. So these coronary vessels are particularly susceptible to getting arterial plaque. When this happens, the blood can't pass, the muscle wall dies, your heart is not able to pump blood any longer because it's not getting the blood it needs. Not enough blood. And so you're thinking, wow, but isn't the heart full of blood? Yeah, but that is blood that's getting pushed out of the heart. It's not diffusing from inside of the heart. It's being supplied by these coronary vessels that are on the surface of the muscle wall that then penetrate down into it. So if these arteries get clogged and clotted and occluded, then that tissue becomes what's called ischemic, starting with I, ischemic, and dies. So that is basic heart disease. So here is hopefully the heart of everybody in this room, including myself. Normal circulation we have, so this is called an angiogram, where they're looking at blood flow through the heart. It's a colorized angiogram. And you see nice perfusion throughout that tissue. Here's a person that has been on a steady diet of Twinkies and cheeseburgers their whole life, and we have a significantly reduced a perfusion of the heart tissue. All right, so now we're going to get down to the real nuts and bolts of what's going on. Everything has been a prelude to this. We're going to talk about how the heart actually works. Okay, the first thing to talk about is how the conduction system of the heart works, where the impulses are coming. So to do that, we're going to talk about the cardiac cardiac cycle. This cardiac cycle is basically a sequence of depolarization events that gets propagated throughout the tissue, the cardiac tissue, the myocardium, of the heart wall, and creates, because of its timing, because of its spatial disposition, is going to create a timing of contraction that will lead to the function of the heart, you know, having the coordinated ejection of blood. It's going to be able to be monitored by the ECG, so the electrocardiogram. It used to be called EKG. Because it was Germans that first did this, but they call it an ECG now because I guess, why not? So it starts with electrical stimulus at the SA node. This propagates down to the AV node, hence down these bundle branches, etc. This leads to a cardiac contraction
This cardiac contraction is going to give us the heart sounds that we'll be able to monitor. This depolarization, like I said, is where we get the ECG. This contraction and ejection of blood is what's going to give us the maintenance of our blood pressure and the blood flow. And then eventually, the cycle is going to reset by cardiac relaxation. And then we'll start the cycle over with another electrical stimulus at the SA node. All right, so let's look at what's happening at the SA node by looking at the electrical potential of the membrane at the SA, at the cells in the SA node. So this is our the membrane potential, and here's time. So this potential minus 40 millivolts is the threshold in a cardiac cell. That's the threshold in the cardiac cell. So we start off, we're at threshold, boom, we have an action potential, and then the gates, or the different ion channels close, and we begin to reset, repolarize the membrane. We come down here, and we get down to this this resting potential. But the thing about cardiac cells is that they don't actually rest at the resting potential. You remember I talked about how in a neuron there's this balance between the leak channels and the sodium potassium ATPase, and that is a reflection of the expression patterns that you're going to see of those different proteins. Well, we have a slightly different type of expression pattern here, such that there's spontaneous depolarization. It's going to spontaneously, the leak channels are going to not be able to maintain a ambient resting membrane potential. So we get a spontaneous gradual depolarization until we reach threshold again and go through another action potential. Kind of have the hiccups. All right. Conduction system. So we'll go through this step by step, although I've said it twice already today. SA activation. The cells at the SA node begin to depolarize. This depolarization spreads throughout the myocardium across the internodal fibers, and that causes contraction of the atrium. All right, and the atrium is going to then force blood through the atria, are going to force blood through those AV valves into the ventricles. Meanwhile, a signal is passing down through the bundle branches in the interventricular septum to the Purkinje fibers. And the moderator band, which is going to control the papillary muscles. So the atria are essentially done with their contraction now, and we are going to begin a contraction of the ventricles. Ventricle contraction begins because all this tissue, has been stimulated. And this is going to be what leads to ejection of blood through the semilunar valves. All right. All of that electrical activity is what gives us the ECG. So this dude is wired, and they're monitoring his heart, and this is what it looks like. So... each of these features, we have a P wave, and then this is the QRS complex, is what they call that, this QRS interval, the QRS complex. And then there's this T wave. So P wave, QRS complex, T wave. This is not the love dub. This is not the, like, put the stethoscope on the heart and listen to it, okay? That's a different thing. It correlates with this, but not maybe in the exact way you might imagine.
This is the electrical activity of the heart. All right, we'll see. We'll match them up. Yes, Andrew. Yeah, this is normal. This guy's fine. He seems alive. The timing is going to change. Yeah, obviously the timing is going to change. Yeah, the timing will change depending upon how fast your heart is beating, and it can also tell you, like, you can have arrhythmia. You know, you've probably met people that can't dance or can't clap to music. They are arrhythmic, and people's hearts are arrhythmic, right? And you can have, and that's a pathology. It's a problem, right? And that can be picked up in terms of the ECG, all right? But you want a healthy heart is going to have this basic structure, all right? This basic structure. I mean, there's giant textbooks written about interpreting the ECG, right? So it's a pretty sophisticated field. But I'm just trying to get you to see a basic ECG. And so the big spike here, this big spike that you see is going to be where the ventricles are depolarizing. The P wave is where the atria depolarizes. The QRS complex is when the massive muscly ventricles depolarize. We get this big spike. And then the T wave is the electrical activity that's picked up as the ventricles repolarize. The repolarization of the P wave gets hidden and washed out by this QRS complex, and it's much smaller anyways, okay? So let's compare this action potential in a cardiac muscle to what happens in a skeletal muscle. Let's look at the cardiac muscle first. So we have depolarization. This step one is this rapid depolarization. There's sodium entering into the cell, and this ends when the voltage-gated channels slam shut, and we begin this plateau. All right. Normally, in a skeletal muscle cell, we get the action potential, and it comes back to baseline very quickly. But in a cardiac muscle cell, we get the spike, but then it plateaus. It plateaus right here. And why is this? There's another player in the game. It's calcium. Calcium. Calcium begins to flood in. And this lasts for quite a while, about 175 milliseconds, and it ends when these slow calcium channels finally close. It's not able to reset the membrane potential because calcium is short-circuiting this process. We get this plateau. And then finally, after a long period of time, we get repolarization with calcium efflux. Calcium is allowed out of the cell in the way that you remember in a skeletal muscle. So consequently, if we compare the skeletal muscle, the blue band there is the absolute refractory period. Remember I told you that's when the cell cannot contract again. It cannot contract again. No matter how many nerve impulses you're sending to it, it's not going to contract. The cardiac muscle has an extremely long absolute refractory period. Why might this be? Yeah. Say that again. The ventricles are going to need to refill with blood. Yes. But couldn't we just pump blood through the system faster? Couldn't the atria just pump blood down there more quickly? Yeah, you're right. I mean, we're going to get to that. Yes, there are some fluid dynamics that are involved. There's another reason. What did I talk about? Yeah. Yes, there needs to be coordination, but why can't we just have the sequence move faster and faster? This is kind of what she's saying. There's something else. Why can't we have the sequence go faster and faster? What?
Is it possible because your
mind is trying to diffuse
like oxygen from your lungs and like
nutrients from the rest? Yeah, but say you are being chased by a laser breath wizard werewolf or something. I don't know. Like something is freaking you out and you need as much oxygen as possible and you're like, whoosh. It does take time, but like, bring it on. There's something else. What happens? I'll ask the question another way. What happens in a skeletal muscle? I might not have explained the slide very well the other day when I was talking about skeletal muscles. Remember that slide that I put up when I was showing how you can change the frequency of contraction when I was talking about wave summation? All right? It's related to that. What happens when you have a really high frequency of contraction? You don't want tetanus in your cardiac muscle. Because if you get tetany, if you allow tension to build up in the cardiac muscle and don't allow it to relax, the heart can't pump. The thing about the heart is you want a repeated cycle. You don't want the heart to just go like that, right? Maybe if you're lifting a big weight, you want to go. But your heart, you want it to be able to relax so it can go through the cycle of pumping. You don't want it to go into tetanus. So we have this long refractory period that allows that muscle fiber to relax the tension in it before you ask it to contract again. It's not just about time to fill the fluid, because you're right, Colette, and give time for the body to distribute the oxygen. Yes, you're right, Andy. But it's also a chance for that muscle fiber to relax and come back to its resting length so that you don't go into tetanus. It's important. You definitely do not want your heart in tetanus. All right. So the cardiac cycle. We've already kind of talked about this in terms of the conduction cycle. But we're going to enter the concept, the vocab words of systole and diastole. Systole is just a word that means contraction. Diastole means relaxation. Let's start at the beginning. Step 1A. So atrial systole begins. Let's start here. Everybody's relaxed. We begin the cardiac cycle, atrial systole begins. And those atria, the SA node must have fired off, and the atrium are contracting. They're going to pump the blood down into the ventricles, and the filling begins. After about 100 milliseconds, atrial diastole begins. The atrium are done contracting. They're done contracting. The blood has passed, all the blood that we're going to get out of here has passed down into the ventricles, and the atria get to relax for most of the time here. So ventricular systole begins, and we begin to build pressure in the heart. This happens where pressure builds, but no blood is being ejected for about another 270 milliseconds for 370 altogether. It's at this point that the ventricles snap, the semilunar valves snap open, blood gets ejected, and then we can begin ventricular diastole and the passive filling of the heart, all right? So all these valves shut here, and we get the normal venous return that begins to passively fill the heart. And this passive filling of the heart is due to the back pressure the preloading from the venous blood pressure that's pushing blood into the heart. Then when all there's been all that preloading that you can get, then we get contraction here and the cycle starts again. What's everyone doing? Did everyone get enough sleep last night? Who did not? I actually didn't. My daughter woke me up. All right. So this chart right here is probably the most integrative one in the talk. It brings all of these concepts together. It packs a lot of punch for a single slide. So it's good to understand what this is showing you. So we've gone through this, right? We've gone through this, and we're going to correlate that with different things as I talk about this. So this panel here is showing the blood pressure in various chambers, in various places, versus time. So let's start with, let's do the left ventricle. Let's not worry about the atrium in blue. Let's just do the left ventricle. So step one is atrial depolarization. The pressure goes up in the left atrium, but it goes up accordingly in the left ventricle as well, all right, because they're communicating through the mitral valve. So blood is flowing from the left atrium into the left ventricle, and until that AV valve closes. So this P wave is associated with the depolarization and contraction of the atrium. All right, that's the P wave. So now here at 3, the ventricle is fully filled, and it's going to begin to contract. That's when we get this boom, QRS depolarization in the wall of the left ventricle. The blood pressure starts to skyrocket in the ventricle. This is your aortic blood pressure. This is the blood pressure out in the vasculature. At a certain point, as soon as the blood pressure in the ventricle equals the blood pressure in the aorta, the valve opens. All right? So imagine there's someone on one side of the door and you're on this side. The door's not going to open until you can push on that door as hard as the other person is pushing the other way. And as soon as you go push harder, then you'll be able to push your way out. Okay? That's what's happening. So the valve snaps open and we eject all this blood until we contract here until we can't squeeze any more blood out of the ventricle because we're, you know, the fluid's going, the volume's going down. And we get to this point where the AV valves snap shut. And this pressure drops. And then the blood gets distributed throughout the aorta. And this is when repolarization, T waves when repolarization happens. This is just volume. This is just volumes. Instead of pressures, we're going to look at volumes. And these volumes are important because we're going to talk about a lot of these terms, end-diastolic volume, end-systolic volume. And we're going to talk about how they relate to notions of cardiac output. Cardiac output, we'll define that in a little bit. But that's a metric, that's a measure of how well your heart is doing. Okay? So we'll see. Cardiac output is essentially the product of your stroke volume and your heart rate. So stroke volume is how much blood. So here's the end diastolic volume of the left ventricle. This is volume, this is time. This is how much blood is in the ventricle just before contraction starts. Or I'm sorry, just before the aorta, the aortic semilunar valve opens. So this is how much blood is in that ventricle right before the doors snap open. Doors snap open and we shove all that blood out. Door snaps shut right here. This is our end systolic volume. So this is the end of diastole. This is right where contraction begins. This is the end of systole. This is where contraction ends. So the difference in these two volumes is the stroke volume. That's how much blood in one stroke your heart was able to pump out in measured in volume, okay, your stroke volume. So the cardiac output is how much of this stroke volume was your heart able to do times your heart rate, how many beats per minute. That's telling you how much blood your heart can pump in a minute, okay, which is the real measure that you want. And then it fills and you go for another cycle. I couldn't fit the bottom part of that panel onto the same sheet, but this syncs up with the lub-dub, the heart sounds, the auscultation, the stethoscope. So when you get on here, the big sounds you can hear is the lub, which is that semilunar valve opening, and the dub, which is that semilunar valve closing. Okay, and then you can have the S4, 3 way sounds, which are much quieter, and those are the AV valves opening and closing. And when you're doing auscultation, there's all these different places on the heart, on the chest, that you can put the stethoscope to listen. And if you put it in each of these different places, it's going to give you different information about that specific region of the heart. So it's heart rate, your heartbeat is going to sound different a little bit. You're going to get some part of the heart rate is going to be louder in some places than the other. An important place, and it's not shown in this picture, is called the triangle of auscultation. I should put a picture of it. But if you feel the bottom corner of your shoulder blade, your scapula, and then you go medial from it, you can feel your rib cage. There's a little part, so the trapezius comes like this, and it's just lateral to the trapezius, and medial to the scapula. If you go on the left side and do that, for some reason my right arm's not going back there so well, but that's called the triangle of auscultation, and it's kind of one of the best places on the body to get the heart rate, because the muscle on the body wall is not very thick right there. Cardiodynamics. Okay. Yeah, so here's what I was talking about. We have these volumes that I talked about. The end diastolic volume, that's the maximal amount of blood that we can fit into the heart, right? It's the volume that's in there at the end of relaxation, right before the heart starts to contract. Then there's the end systolic volume. The difference between them is the stroke volume. And that's measured in milliliters per beat. All right? The ejection fraction is the percent of the end diastolic volume, this right here, represented by the stroke volume. So when you get down here, there's this little bit of blood. How much blood is left over? How much blood is the heart not pumping? Okay? So that fraction of this stroke volume per the totality of the end diastolic volume, that's what we call the ejection fraction. It's a percentage. Finally, it's the cardiac output. This is an important number. This is the volume that is pumped by the left ventricle in a minute. And you find that just by multiplying beats per minute times milliliters per beat. Beats cancel and you get milliliters per minute. All right? Happy times. Got those definitions inside? I'm going to skip this slide. This is just a picture helping you visualize stroke volume, but I feel like I explained that well. You guys got stroke volume? It's just stroke volume is just showing, it's like pumps. You know, here's all the volume of your heart. You push it down. The blood that comes out is the stroke volume. This would be like end diastolic volume. I don't know. It's probably maybe not that useful slide. Okay, so the capacity of an athlete is going to be related to their cardiac output, right? Because the more blood you can, the capacity to move blood, the higher the capacity you have to move blood to your periphery, to your muscles, is going to be an important factor in making sure you've outran the zombie or the werewolf or the mother-in-law or, I don't know, whoever you're running away from. Mother-in-laws are lovely, actually. My mother-in-law is really sweet. So these are the factors that affect that. We can affect heart rate, or we can affect stroke volume, right? Because we said cardiac output is the heart rate times stroke volume. So let's take stroke volume first, because this is what we've been talking about. There's two ways to affect stroke volume. You can affect end diastolic volume or end systolic volume. So how much blood can you fit in the heart, or how much blood can you squeeze out of the heart? All right, those are the two factors that are going to affect stroke volume. And we're going to talk about how to affect those two things in the next slide. But on the other side is the heart rate. So how do you do that? You can get some hormones in the game, like epinephrine. You see the zombie in-law coming, and your heart rate starts going crazy because you've released all this epinephrine into your blood. And it speeds up, it affects that leak rate. And I think I have a slide that'll show that. It affects the threshold. Or you can have autonomic innervation. So this comes from, do you guys remember? Who's really listening? I did say it. What nerve? What nerve is it that is going to affect the heart rate via this autonomic innervation? Do you guys remember? Phrenic. Nope, close. Phrenic is the diaphragm. Yeah, so you were listening close, but this you had to be really listening close because I just glossed over it super fast. The vagus! Good job, you win. I wish I had a cookie. That's it. It was the vagus nerve. Vagus it comes from the same root word as vagrant. What is a vagrant? A wanderer, someone who wanders. The vagus nerve is the wandering nerve of the body. It's a cranial nerve, comes off the midbrain, the brain stem, the medulla. And it's going to give autonomics to the heart, either sympathetic or parasympathetic. Sympathetic, if you're trying to speed it up, in the cardiac acceleratory nuclei, or slow it down with parasympathetic, the fight or flight, and the rest and digest. All right. Oh, yeah, here we go. Here is a slide that shows that. So here we have, this is the medulla. Here's the cardioacceleratory center and the cardiac inhibitory center. The cardioinhibitory center is coming down with this vagus nerve. And it's going over the heart. This is how you slow your heartbeat down. You've seen people, this cardiac inhibitory center does receive cortical projections. You've seen people, maybe you can do it yourself. If you come to my yoga class, I'll show you how. People who can lower their heart rate by thinking about it, right? There are people who can... They don't tell their heart to beat or not beat, but they can slow their heart rate down. That's via fibers through cranial nerve 10 here, the vagus nerve that's coming out of the medulla. On the other hand, the sympathetic chain ganglia, this is what's going to speed the heart up. This is coming through this cardiac nerve, which is not important to know, but it's coming off the sympathetic chain ganglia and has the opposite effect. Also originating, the signal is originating in the medulla oblongata. Okay, so you can think about something scary. You can think about the final exam or the amount of homework you have or something like that, and not taking my advice and being relaxed about it. And you can make your heart move faster as well, can't you? So,
and that's here. This is the autonomic innervation. I talked about that, and we're going to talk about these two now in more detail.
All right. Oh, yeah. So, how do we speed the heart rate up? How do we slow the heartbeat down?
Here is a parasympathetic stimulation, or with acetylcholine, we have. Here's the normal threshold. Instead, we just bring that threshold down here. All right, and so it's going to take longer for a cardiac cycle to happen. If you move it up, you're going to have reduced repolarization, but you're going to have a slower depolarization now with this hyperpolarization. So on the other hand, we have sympathetic stimulation, or norepinephrine, if you're talking about the hormonal control, and it's again going to change this threshold so that we have a more rapid depolarization. So this is going all the way down here to minus 70 or something, whereas in with sympathetic stimulation, you're only going down to about 50, and it has a much shortened time to depolarize and hit the action potential. Okay, so we're just monkeying with these repolarization, the hyperpolarization, and the hypopolarization. All right. Ways. This is a seemingly complex slide, but this has a lot of information in it. So let's a lot of good stuff here. It's not actually that complicated. We're just going to walk through it. So let's start with end diastolic volume. So there's really the main way of affecting end diastolic volume, how much blood is in the heart, is by preloading it. How do you affect the preload? There's two ways. There's venous return and filling time. So how much blood is being returned from the body is going to affect how much the preload is and consequently the end diastolic volume, and how long you let it fill is going to affect the preload and the end diastolic volume. So if you have a long fill time, so a long period between heartbeats, the longer you wait in between heartbeats, the more the preload, the larger your end diastolic volume, or the more blood that's being returned from the venous system is also going to affect that. If you have a decreased fill time, you're going to have a decreased end diastolic volume, and then a lower stroke volume. On the other side, it's how to affect end diastolic volume. And there's two ways. There's either contractility of the muscle cells themselves, or afterload. And afterload is the pressure that the ventricle is working against out in the aorta. All right, does that make sense? So it's if there's a high pressure in afterload, if there's a high arterial pressure, if you have high blood pressure, you're going to have high afterload, and you're going to have a high end systolic volume, meaning you haven't pumped very much blood out of the heart. Okay, so that's going to reduce your stroke volume, right, if you have a high afterload. And if you have a low afterload, if it's not working against a lot of blood pressure, then you're going to have a low end systolic volume, meaning you've pumped most of the blood out of the heart, giving you a larger stroke volume. So when in a person, not comparing person to person with your blood pressure, but within a single person, how do you affect afterload? You can increase your vasoconstriction, so your blood vessels get smaller, so the volume of space that your blood is occupying gets smaller. That's going to raise the pressure of your blood, and that's going to have this increase on afterload. Or you could do the opposite. You could have vasodilation, so increasing the volume. Your blood vessels are expanding, right? So you're increasing that volume, thus decreasing afterload and pumping more blood out, thus increasing stroke volume. Okay, follow all that? So this vasodilation and vasoconstriction can relate to exercise, right? When you're exercising, often there's a lot of vasodilation. You're increasing that, you're increasing end systolic volume by decreasing afterload that the heart has to work against. Then on the other side, contractility, this is both the nerve and endocrine inputs. You can have parasympathetic or sympathetic. You can have cholinergic or norepinephrine inputs into the system and increase or decrease the contractility of the muscle. The more it contracts, the more it's going to eject. So this is just taking all that and putting it all on one slide. I could probably have cut that one out, so I'm not going to take any time to revisit all that. Yeah, okay, so I talked about this in lab. So I'm not going to talk about this one either, but I do want to make a point here. And that is this notion of elastic arteries versus muscular arteries. The biggest arteries, you may think to yourself, wow, the aorta is probably really strong. It's probably the biggest, most muscly artery in my body. Well, that's not actually true. The largest arteries are more elastic, and they have less muscle. What they do is they stretch. Okay, the aorta gets the heaviest flow of blood. It stretches. So it increases its volume during a stroke. Not a thrombosis or ischemic event, a cardiac stroke during ejection. Why? Why does the aorta do this? What's the advantage of this? What do you think? Yeah, do it. It's definitely going to reduce the afterload. So in so doing, it's going to increase stroke volume. Yes, absolutely. What else? Yeah. That's it. Both of those. Those are the two answers. Yeah, it decreases the pressure. So if it was really rigid, you'd get this force of blood that's slamming into the body. And you have really wide pressure swings in your vasculature, right? But because that aorta absorbs some of the energy from the heart as it expands and then releases it slowly as it comes back to shape, it's sort of evening that blood flow out, taking the peaks out of the pressure wave. All right, that's sharp. Okay, and then it's these muscular arteries that are a little bit smaller that have a much thicker tunica media. One thing I wanted to say that's kind of interesting in terms of cardiodynamics, I talked about the bifurcation of the aorta. There's a pressure wave that bounces back. There's a pressure wave that bounces back from a heartbeat that helps close the length of the aorta. There's a pressure wave that comes back after a stroke, an ejection has come down, bounces back and helps that those semilunar valves snap shut and reset the system. But that's some like deep nuance of the cardioanatomy there. Capillary structure, There are continuous capillaries, and there's these fenestrated ones. Fenestra, for those of you who speak French, it means window. So they're just ones with little pores in them. That will become important when we talk about the kidneys. That's all. Vasomotion. So in a capillary bed, the capillary beds have these rippling waves of vasoconstriction. So in any given time, blood isn't passing through the entire capillary bed all at once. It's going through one part or another. Maybe this part would be shut off with these pre-capillary sphincters, and this part would be open, whatever. So there's a continuously rippling effect of vasoconstriction throughout the capillary beds because the capillary volume is actually quite large. Capillary filtration. I don't need to talk about that. Here's some pathology. Aneurysm. So an aneurysm is a weakness in the wall of an artery, and you can get these balloons that bubble out. Here's fusiform, a saccular aneurysm. The problem is when these rupture, sometimes these saccular are also called Berry aneurysms. This is deadly right here. This will kill you. I had an aunt that died during childbirth from one of these. So here is the circle of Willis. This is the basilar artery, the vertebral arteries. The carotids would be in here. This is your pituitary gland would be right here. Here's a Berry aneurysm at the base of the circle of Willis. This would kill you in a minute right there. But apparently this person is getting it dealt with. They set a little a platinum wire up there to embolize this, clot that off, and prevent it from rupturing. So it's a new world we live in. It's pretty beautiful. This is an important concept that I actually started the day with, and so I'm going to kind of end it here. And this is, how does blood get back to the heart? After the blood has passed through the capillary bed, the pressure of the pulse pressure has been dissipated. So the blood returns, it gets pushed by the back pressure of the blood coming behind it, but it can't go backwards because of these valves, right? These valves prevent backflow. But better than that, once blood is in a certain venous compartment, those veins are amid the muscles, and when a muscle contracts, it squeezes on the vein. The blood can only go one direction. Okay, the blood can go only one direction. So you do in fact get much better circulation by moving around using your muscles. My blood is circulating better than yours. Okay. Whatever I can do to keep you awake at this time of the day. Most of the blood is in your veins. The bulk of the volume of the cardiovascular system is in the veins. Some is in the heart. Most of it is not in your arteries. What am I going to talk about here? I'm not going to talk about that. That's painful. Here's the last slide. So we measure blood pressure with this sphygmomanometer. Sphygmomanometer. I should have known romance is gone from my relationship when you bought me an aneroid sphygmomanometer for Christmas. Yeah. Always fails to crack them up. So here is a diagram showing the blood pressure in your body as a function of where it is, from the aorta all the way back to the vena cava. And you can see once it goes to the capillary beds, this blood pressure drops very, very low. All right. And this is just your systolic and your diastolic pressure. Your mean arterial pressure. This is a concept. So sphygmomanometer, this is something you're going to need to be able to measure in lab tomorrow. We're going to talk about it with Zach. But a mean arterial pressure, so two-thirds of the time, your heart is resting. One-third of the time, it's contracting. That means that your average or mean arterial pressure is two-thirds times your diastolic pressure and one-third times the systolic. If you were to average this wave out, you would get your mean arterial pressure. because it's here in diastole 2/3 of the time and it's in systole 1/3 of the time. Does that make sense? And that's actually the mathematical calculation you'll do. It's a rough estimate, the 1/3, 2/3, but it gets pretty close. Okay? And we'll talk about that in lab tomorrow. Thank you. Are there questions? Oh, yeah, whatever. Don't worry about this. The recap. No? Yes? Good? Okay. No, I didn't talk about any pathology, did I?
No.
Yeah, no. You know, if it's in a slide and I talk about it, then it's fair game. If it's in a slide and I said, and I kind of like flew past it, and it's in the quiz, then I'll turn it into a bonus. But I put the pathology in there just to interest you guys, mostly, is why I do that. Remember.